Our children are continuously being taught now that Columbus discovered America. Through your work and research, you have found something to counter this. Can you set us all straight now on this story about Columbus discovering America?
Okay. I appeared before Congress on July the 7th of last year. In fact, there's a special tape here. Found certainly before Congress, and the transcript of the appearance before Congress, the congressional testimony. And I appeared before Congress because I had been invited to speak to the Congressional Oversee Committee, which was to look at what the Christopher Columbus Quincentenary Commission was doing. There's going to be a tremendous celebration in 1992, which will celebrate the so-called discovery of America by Columbus. I came to establish quite clearly that Columbus did not discover America, that that word is a word that should never be used, because there were visitors, important visitors, significant visits and contacts and voyages long before Columbus. I'm not alone in that view. As early as 1964, the Congress of Americanists ruled there cannot now be any doubt that there were visits from the old world to America long before Columbus. So that is a myth that has been dismissed. People have come to accept the Vikings were there in 1000 AD because the Vikings are European. Nobody questions that. That has even entered some of our history books. Because this involves Africans, and some of it is much earlier, 1000 AD is long after the Olmec. So some of the visits of Africans is after the Olmec period, some is before or during that Olmec period. Like the plant life, the Gossypium hirsutescum moved from Africa to here long before the Olmec. Some visits are in the Olmec period. Some are in the medieval period, 14th century. Some are in the 15th century. Some are even around the Moorish period. And the thing that I want to close with is to point out that as a result of my testimony, the chairman of the Congressional Oversee Committee said clearly to the Quincentenary Commission that you should not, in the light of Van Sertman's testimony, you should not refer to these visits as discoveries. They should simply be called voyages or contacts. But the reason why this big discovery idea comes in is because European types who had conquered the world, who had carved up Africa and taken over the Native American world, they want to claim that the world was asleep until they came, so that it was lying dormant until they discovered that other part of the world. And that is a word, therefore, has to pass out of our vocabulary. The other important thing is that Christopher Columbus himself was the first person to suggest, not I, that there were these people who had come and visited the Native Americans before him. We found, as the inquiry that came out of my testimony, that there was only one black on the commission. There were no Native Americans. This was being dominated by people who thought that they had actually created the New World, the Spanish, the Italians, etc. All very well, Columbus was a great man to them, but to plant that myth upon the world and to make us feel that we are discovered people, that is very pernicious. Columbus, as I said to Congress, never once put his foot on American landmass, north or south. He only went into the Caribbean, the mere periphery of America. He, on the third voyage, his ships landed in South America, but he did not set foot on the continent at all.
I want to thank you very much, because now the record can be straight and our children don't have to come home and ask us, did Columbus discover America? And now it's just voyages rather than discoveries. But after authoring the book that came before Columbus, I noticed you had mentioned one time about you did not feel that you were going to be published again, and that you felt a need, for there was so much material out there that needed to be published, that you started the Journal of African Civilizations. Why did you start this journal?
Well, that was an absolute necessity. One thing became very clear to me, that I could waste my whole life pursuing that subject and that no one would ever take it seriously, that they had to take Africa seriously before they could actually look at that thesis seriously. Because most of the objections arose from the fact that people felt that this was absurd, if Africans, after all, were just primitives, if they had no great technology, if they had easily been defeated in the slave trade, how dare you suggest that they could cross the Atlantic, which Europeans had not yet crossed? Mm-hmm. How dare you suggest that they could influence a major civilization? So that I made a conscious decision before I continue with this work and to pursue these threads, I had to spend at least 10 years, probably more, in developing a school of thought where one could draw upon a body of discovery and research all over the world, where one could establish that the African was not what he was thought to be, that there were levels of technological complexity there in that continent, which we were not aware of and have not been aware of because we've been looking in the wrong place and because we've had a different notion and conception of the African. That is how I started the Journal of African Civilizations.
Mm-hmm.
And that led to major books like Blacks in Science, Ancient and Modern, where scientists from all over the world in the field of medicine, aeronautics, agriculture, pastoral farming, astronomy, metallurgy, scripts, etc., could establish clearly this was how it was,
mm-hmm.
to provide vast bibliographies so students could study anew, not just slave history, which is significant and valuable since it's the last chapter of our history, but to study what really happened before.
Mm-hmm.
Who was the African before he was shattered, before the slave trade had broken up his empires? What did he really do? What was that lost world? So here you have, for example, African presence in early America, his presence in the American continent, African presence in early Europe, his presence and impact on Europe, African presence in early Asia, his presence and impact on Asia, and a range of other works
mm-hmm.
that deal with the African. These works have been, we now have about 10 of these titled works,
mm-hmm.
and they engage experts from all the fields.
Black women in antiquity. Could you just give us a summary of what this is about, black women in antiquity?
Black women in antiquity deals with the history of the black woman from very early times. It shows you the remarkable figure of the black woman in Egypt and Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. It shows you how black women had been turned into goddesses, not only by Africans, but Europeans.
Mm-hmm.
Europeans also worshipped black women. For example, the most important black woman in the world was Isis. Isis was the female aspect of God. Osiris was the male aspect of God. Isis was the female aspect of God, and she was a black woman.
Mm-hmm.
And the statues of Isis in Egypt were eventually transported, prototype for the black Madonna. So all over Europe, Europeans worshipped the black woman. And she had a little child, Horus, who became the Christ figure, so that after Jesus died, for a long time, even when he was accepted as the Christ figure, the black woman and her child, her black child, was accepted as Mary and Jesus. Mm-hmm. And then when these statues were broken up or lost, the Europeans would make new statues, some of them with European features, but black skin.
Mm-hmm.
So that became the Black Madonna. You can still find many of them in Poland, in Spain, in the Soviet Union, all over the world.
Photograph Mr. and Mrs. Ivan Van Sertima, welcome to Los Angeles.
It's our pleasure.
And I just wanted to do this so that my family will have a photographic documentation of two of the greatest people on the planet.
Oh, we're honored.
And thank you for coming.